So I've mentioned self-rule, and I've mentioned lowercase r republicanism as defining of the American experience in the 17th and 18th century. But what other great influence that takes hold within what will become the United States is what we would call the tradition within political philosophy of modern liberalism. And probably the modern liberal par excellence is a man named John Locke. Now, I imagine that many of you at one point or another in a high school history class have come along or crossed that name, John Locke, and have realized that, okay, he plays an important part because he has an influence on Jefferson. But you really don't get the details of what Locke was arguing, and you don't understand the incredible revolution that Locke's thought brings into being. So what you're going to do and what I've assigned to you in this reading is the beginning of John Locke's second treatise. And you see right at the beginning that Locke is about to make a very, very important argument. He says that we have to be able to distinguish a difference between paternal power and political power. And what had happened up until that time is that we had understood political power in terms of paternal power. So we grant someone a right to rule like we grant a father a right to rule over a family. So we think about our political leaders as our fathers. And Locke says that that's the completely wrong way to go about authority. Because if you grant to a political leader the position of a father, you're granting to them kind of a godlike role that they haven't earned or deserved. So when you're taking a look at kings or queens or individuals, these ones that I've mentioned from the past who aren't deserving of rule, you're giving them kind of a godlike ability that they shouldn't have. So how should we understand political power aright? Well, instead of reading political power in terms of God granted Adam authority, Adam's sons have authority, and thereafter, right up until the present day where kings have authority, give the authority to the eldest born male, Locke says no. Locke says we have to imagine what human beings are within a state of nature. And what are we within the state of nature? We have been endowed by our Creator with the faculty of reason. And that faculty of reason that we all share makes us what? Makes us equal and perfectly free. So what is Locke done here? Locke says that when you want to look at political power aright, you have to understand the relationship between God and man. And he defines that relationship in terms of the gift that God has given man of his possession of the faculty of reason. If we all have reason, we all have a rightful ability to rule over ourselves. We have a rightful ability to exercise our liberty. We have a rightful ability to acquire property, to pursue happiness. So politics must begin with that defining feature rather than this picture of the world that kings rightfully rule over us because they are the descendants of Adam. So Locke will go on in this treatise on government to say the following. If by state of nature we are perfectly free and equal, can we use our liberty? Can we pursue happiness in a way that leads to the flourishing of all? And he says that most people can. Most people can be ruled by their reason. They can associate with one another, and they can form communities, and they can make laws for themselves. They can adjudicate for themselves. They can rule over themselves, and everything is peaceful. But there are some bad apples among us who would use their self-love to transgress the law. So yes, the system of government based upon perfect equality and liberty is essential to understanding power aright. But also essential is that we need to realize that perhaps we can create in an artificial government something that better secures our liberty. So the establishment of a modern liberal state that's brought into being to secure for us our life and our liberty and our ability to acquire property and pursue happiness will become the next stage in Locke's political philosophy. Now he'll end here, and this is very important for where we're going in the next module. Yes, we have a natural equality and freedom given to us by our possession of the faculty of reason. Yes, we have to establish government to better secure for ourselves that flourishing. But thirdly, if that government that we establish, instead of securing for us our liberties, abuses us, takes away our liberties, we have the right to be judges in our own case and to take that government and remove it from its rule and to put in its place a new government that will better secure our liberties. So here what Locke has done is something very revolutionary. The authority rightfully rests in us, and we can employ that authority both at the beginning of our regime and, if necessary, to undo the regime that rules over for us. This very much is essential to understanding the American expression of right governance in the 18th century.